Ben Horner for Norwich Boxing, here with Michael Walsh, the knockout sensation, and Liam Walsh, British and Commonwealth super featherweight champion. Unfortunately, Ryan's not here, but I'll start with you, Michael. Two brothers, both holding British titles. How proud are you to be?
I couldn't be any proud, honestly. It was the dream that all of us had, and we used to think it'd be easy to win a British title. We all said, you know, British titles and sort of starting point, you know, but it wasn't as easy as it seemed, and they've both gone and done it. I haven't managed to do it. I haven't had the opportunity offered to me as of yet. If that comes, I'll fight again. If the title fight don't come, I don't know, I'll still be there. But I'll always love boxing, I'll always stay in the gym. I love what my brothers do. They're both very professional what they do. Train hard, live the life 24/7, which, again, I can't say I did that all the way through my career. But give me a chance, and yeah, I'll do 12 weeks where I'll get it together again and we'll have a go at it. But otherwise, like I said, I'll be in boxing, I'll be watching what they're doing, pushing them all the way, like I've done since they started, really. And yeah, proud as it could be. Just wish my dad had been here to see it as well, because he put a lot of the work in as well before I started hoping. And yeah, but very proud, yeah.
Obviously, without yourself, like, it took the two of you to write your names in history to be the first twins to hold the British title. Something I asked Ryan was, what have you two said since to think that you're now both the first ever twins to hold the British title? Like, have you spoke about it, or?
We haven't really, to be honest. It's been a bit of a hectic week with Ryan winning the title. He's had a lot of stuff to do and we've both been busy, so we haven't really had time to sit down and sort of speak about it. Or.
But it was majorly on Ryan's mind all the way up to that fight. Yeah. He's very sentimental with things like that, you know, like he had to write his name, you know, he was saying things like, we're putting our name in the mystery books. And
yeah, yeah.
So really sentimental to Ryan. To be honest with you, I think me and Liam, like, a bit goes over our heads, things like that a little bit. And it'll all come down to achievements at the end, as Liam always says, but like, Ryan's really into them sort of things, wants to have his name in history, and so yeah, proud of him for doing that. But
maybe one day we'll look back and say, I'll myself probably look back and say, yeah, it was a good achievement, but right now, like Michael said, it's not something that...
A world title to goal. Yeah, I'm proud of him for British titles, but without disrespecting that British title anywhere, they're not world class, and they're not world champion until they've got a world title belt in the West.
Yeah. I am world class, I'm just not world champion.
I've told him I'm the one who's going to keep his feet on the ground. I've told him he can be world class when he gets a world title wearing his worst, which I do believe he'll get. But until then, I'm not going to agree he's world class. He can prove that first, which I think he will. I think Ryan will as well. It's all in good time. So I think I'm glad them British titles are passed. They've got past them now, because the next step is just a world title, and they need to know if they can get that, and if they can, all the careers will be good, won't it? But I think this game is not for getting nearly there. You're either going to make it or you're not, and you can have a good career in boxing. If you fall short on the world title fights, you're having a lot of hard fights and a lot of, you know, it's an hard game then.
It's sort of, this is something that, I mean, you've got involved in as well, but you and your brother, Mitchell Smith.
Do we have to even give him a time? Honestly, please let me have him. He should not be allowed to fight my brother Ryan, right? I'd happily let him. But he's not warranted to fight him, he's not earned the right to fight him, he's never made 9 stone. I've been sat out for ages. The last person I fight with a right dustbin, man, honestly. I knocked him over in a minute and a half, proper can, pretty much like Mitchell Smith. Please get me the fight with him. Let me fight him first. If he can beat me, he's warranted fighting my brother Ryan. But let him fight me first. I'll make 9 stone. I made 9 stone on my last fight in April. He ain't even made 9 stone. He's meant to be a fully active fighter. I only came back for a shit and a shave, you know, to have a shower of it, you know. 12-week camp, and I made 9 stone. He's living boxing all his life and can't make 9 stone. And keeps talking about my brothers to make himself relevant. The guy's a little prick, and I'll beat him up at any time he wants. And then if he can beat me, if he can shut my mouth, then he can go and fight my brother Ryan. Otherwise, I'll fight him any time. I'll cancel that, but yeah, I don't like him. He's a tool, and he's just making himself relevant off my brothers. And I'd like to say, I'm not fully active. I'm running 3 times a week, training 2x a week. Tell him, give me 8 weeks, and me and him will get it on.
I think he's very entertaining. I don't think he's for real. I think he's actually quite funny. I think he amuses me. I'm forgot about it. My name gets mentioned, and he's sort of like, who's he? Yeah. Like, he's completely forgot about me, but he's entertaining. He's good for boxing. I think he's funny, and I think it's good what he's doing. And I don't think, like I said, I don't think he's for real, really. I think he just does it to get his name out there, so fair play to
him. But then that's the character, my brother Liam. He don't take anybody seriously. He don't let anything rile him. Me and my brother Ryan, we can take the bear. He's got on my tits, the kid has. Because I'll say, I know sparring means nothing, but I brought him in this gym and I was out of shape. He was meant to be sparring Liam. Liam didn't show up to the gym that day. He had it at his hand. So I came to the gym just to see Graham. I weren't even in training. And he said to me, I've got some sparring here. We're going to let the kid down. But he's ABA champion. I went, go on, I'll move him around for 6. I punched him around the ring. And when he got out, he said he had motion sickness. The geezer's a tool. He can't fight. He's knocking out a few journeymen, looking good doing it. I'll give him that. And if he wants to fight any of us, we've all said yeah 100 times. Just tell him to say yeah, and one of us will fight him. We've all said yeah so many times, we can't see any more times. We've even gone to the point of ringing Frank Warren, Andy Ehlen, and they'll vouch that, and asking for the fight, and they've told us we're not allowed near him because he's a ticket seller. That's all he is, he sells five. He's got 5,000 friends on Facebook. He's done 1,500 tickets to Chris Eubanks and Billy Joe. He's a massive ticket seller. It's good business. And if he wants his business to continue, don't come anywhere near the Walsh brothers, honestly.
Brilliant.
Why did you ask?
But back to yourself, you're unfortunately not out this weekend, which was the hope. Terry Flanagan is defending his world title, which you were looking at a final eliminator for. Do you think that could still sort of
hopefully,
come
off? Fingers crossed. Obviously, I'm going to go up to Manchester and watch that fight this week, and I'd love to fight the winner. I hid on that fact from the last fight, the last press conference, when that question was asked. You could see I clearly want to fight for a world title, whether it be at lightweight or super featherweight. And if the next option is going to be at lightweight, then that's it. Flanagan, Magdalena, either one, I'd fancy I can beat him. On my night, I beat both of them, so I just need to get back, get this hand back ready and strong again, and I want to fight the winner. Whoever wins, I want to fight him.
I hope Terry wins it, because it'd be lovely to do it on home turf for all the fans that have followed me, brother, because they've followed him far and long and far, all up and down the country. We've had 300-400 from Norfolk, a couple of hundred coming up from Rochdale. Got a good fan base now, 500-600. It's not massive, but if he was only going in on our own with 500-600 tickets, though, he's good tickets to buy as well. So he's got a brilliant little fan base, very good fan base, and they're as loud as 2,000, that's for sure. That's when they're in our crowd, they're as loud as 2,000 to 10,000.
Yeah.
And for him to win a world title in front of them, I think it'd be a pleasure for them as well, and you know, I'd be really happy for
and
them.
And in Norwich, hopefully.
They've, like I said, they've followed him everywhere, so if he did have to go to fight Magdalena or over in the stairs, it'd be brilliant for him and everything else, but you're not going to get as many to follow you, they're going to watch on telly, and I'd like that. I'd like the atmosphere.
Yeah.
I'd like him to win it on his own turf, but wherever he gets a shot at a world title, that's where I don't get a say in anything. If it's a world title, it's his job,
and
he ain't going to let anybody tell him no, that's it.
You touched on Norwich. There has been sort of strong rumours, and Frank Warren himself has even said, hopefully get a show on in Norwich. Something Ryan said was, you two have been discussing who would headline the bill.
Yeah.
What's your views on that?
I think that would be me, because I'd sell the most tickets.
Do a step the twins down and bring Michael in.
Yeah,
headline the bill.
I suppose it depends on who gets the bigger fight. They'd need a big fight for it to come to Norwich, and we understand that. Hopefully that would be me for a world title, but things can change very quick in boxing. He's not saying Ryan won't be pushed onto a European title, a big title, quick. Anything can happen. Look at Orville McKenzie last week, 11 days now, it's world title, shot, bang. Anything can happen, so there's not saying
it ain't going to happen in the next 11 days, I'll tell you, it needs to be at least 6 weeks.
You don't know what's going to happen, so depending on who has the bigger fight, really. At the minute, I think I'm in pole to get the biggest fight, but you don't know, we'll see what comes.
Then it all comes down onto the opponent as well.
Joking aside, because that's all it is between us joking, none of us care. Would love to box on the same bill. Would love to box in Norwich. I'd love to fight in Norwich. I boxed in Norwich once as an amateur when I was about 12 years old, and I haven't boxed there since. I'd love to fight in Norwich. It'd be really, really mean a lot to me to give everything back to these fans that followed me all around the country.
That's
boxed in Manchester
three times.
I boxed in Wigan. I boxed in London. I boxed everywhere, and they've all followed me. And the support I've always had has been humbling. And I just wish I could fight here and repay them, so they could only get a taxi up the road. That'd be much better. I'd love it.
I think it's possible as well, because like I said, there's a lot of talk of it coming from there. So.
From the city itself, I mean, everyone seems to sort of be talking about, even people who aren't boxing fans
I think it's about time. I think Liam took all his right chances, which is brilliant. He fought Maxwell Awuku and stuff. He was 9 fights deep.
Yeah.
9 fights deep. Shouldn't be fighting a Commonwealth title at 9 fights. Not against a kid who'd had 36, 135 or something. Fair enough, an African. But the toughest kid he's had in front of him, as for what he could take up to now. You know, and he took that opportunity, he took the fight, he won the fight, he then went on to fight Paul Appleby, got off the canvas to win in the fight of the year, you know. So he took his opportunities. But to be fair to me and Ryan, I'm not slagging the Frank Warren's office or anything, because they had done everything they could for us, but I don't think we've been promoted that well, and I think it's because that road into Norwich weren't brilliant, but now they've got two lanes coming now, there is actually talk of it, but otherwise that was the first time Ryan's been offered a title. Before that he had to ring up and ask for the British title. I've never been offered one, I've never been rung up and said, can you fight for this title or anything. Yeah, I've always been active, I've always kept my medical open, So I don't think we've been promoted brilliantly, but I think now it's actually getting to the point where I think there is getting talk, and I think they're going to start having a go at it. I hope for my sake, it's not too late for me, but for them two, it'll be fine anyway. But I think they're a bit late in the day in pushing us, you know.
It's an unlucky scenario, really, because...
We turned up with all the Olympians, bearing in mind, as well.
It's the business matters. We do not have an indoor arena in Norwich. There's no indoor arena, so the only way that they could have... Frank Warren or Queensbury Munch could come to Norwich to do the showground, which has massive overheads, you know, so it hasn't really been feasible to come here.
And people like to say it's just a caution.
Yeah,
but.
So it hasn't been feasible to come here. If they can get a couple of big fights, myself, Ryan, what have you, maybe bring a few in, you can then do Carrow Road.
Yeah.
So that's now why, because we've got ourselves in this position, it's the only reason it's now becoming available. It's not their fault that there isn't an indoor arena in Norwich. It's not our fault there isn't an indoor.
No.
It's a shame the city haven't gone into arena, because I think we'd have all been pushed on more and had more fights. But
I will step in there, just so you know, there is big talks of an arena being built.
We have heard, yeah.
Broadland Business Park.
Yeah, that's right.
For Norwich Boxing, the sooner the better, because you've got Liam and Ryan, who are really rolling at the minute, both champions, but then on the back end of that, you've got Sam Sexton, who's back in the gym now, training, not a fight no longer, fought myself not long ago in April. Me and Sam both sell big tickets in Norwich, we get a lot of people out. You've got Nathan Dale, a brilliant little prospect coming up, Billy Bird. Danny McIntosh has even started back using this gym at times, you know. At the minute, there could be a big night of boxing for all, and from all the Norwich fighters that are from here, but it's how quick they get around to it, really, because I'm definitely on the time scale.
One other thing that, like, because I talked to Ryan a fair bit online, and obviously you go over to Tenerife and get training over there. It goes to show how hard you train over there, because none of you come back with a massive tan, or
no.
So you must be spending a lot of time in the gym. How do you feel that's benefited you?
Massively. I can't lay all the emphasis on the going to Tenerife is why we've improved, because I think we've improved with age and experience as well. So I can't say, would I not have been there, because we was getting better with age and experience. But the fact we're taken away from a comfortable environment, and we're stuck up in a mountain with no TV to watch, with Spanish TV, which we obviously don't watch. So all our focus is boxing. No internet, you're cut off from the world nearly, and all your focus is boxing. All you're worried about when you wake up is going running. When you get back from running, you're worried about when you're going to gym. It's actually, you end up spending 3 and 4 and 5 hour sessions, because you don't want to go on, because it's boring. There's nothing to do, honestly.
We've got a PlayStation 3 with FIFA, UFC on it, and we have an hour on that, and that's it.
Yeah,
but the other thing is, it fits the Walsh's lifestyle. We're all together. We're all on our own. We don't have anybody minding us. Whereas where we live in Cromer, it's brilliant, but we live in the middle of town. That means nearly every person who walks past our house knocking on the door, oh, you lads, you know, and they pop in, they say hello. You don't really get a minute, even if you're sitting eating your dinner and things like that. When we're over there, we've got Liam's girlfriend, Sarah, who's she's been a wonder to all our camps. Since we went to Tenerife, that was the main thing. Could we get the diet right? Could we get these things right? Because we're literally 10 minutes from the gym, you're up in the mountain, you come down the mountain, she's done all our food, diets, everything. So. I think it were absolutely massive, but again, they were always going to get to where they were going to get, because they're always going to put this dedication and the commitment. But as for the environment, what we've got there, we're running at 2,100 metres altitude, we're running down on the beach in the mornings, which is lovely. It doesn't feel like a training camp every day, and then you're training 2 hours twice a day, and then we're all together all the time, the diet's perfect, and we're away from all distractions. So I think it's massive, but I don't think we're finished there. I think we've still got to look at America yet. If they can both now start looking at world titles, heading that way, that's the next step. I want them both to go to America. We're going to do it a couple of months, so then see how we get on with that.
We have learned a lot over there, definitely.
I believe you can learn
every trainer you go to has got their own stamp on how they want to do it, and you do learn bits and bobs off everybody. Steve Collins himself, I think he had like 8-9 trainers in the end. He said he moved around because he learned what he could learn. And that's not to say we've learned everything we can off Graham, because we're all learning all the time, but you do learn bits and bobs off different people, and if you can add little bits to your game, you're going to improve, aren't you?
But again, I would say with a trainer, one of the biggest pluses with a trainer, it's not all about everything he knows in boxing. He needs to know you. He needs to be, you need to be able to trust him. And one thing I will say about Graham, he's got all our interests at heart, and unfortunately, he's still our trainer, but he's very close to a family friend as well, So now we have to get about a little bit, and Graham, being the man he is, respects that, because he knows we've got to the point where we can laugh and a joke, and it's a bit friendly, you know. So every now and then it's good when we go over to Tenerife, because it breaks that a little bit, because we're our other trainer. We ain't got them years of friendship and loyalty built with him. So every now and then he'll tell you, fucking shut up, carry on, do what you're doing, you know. And it's good again, keeps you in check. So in which case, I think you've always got to keep moving around. But what I would say is Graham will be with us all the way through, because we're loyal lads. He's a friend of ours, always has been, and he's always done his job, he's always kept them doors open, he's done a good job.
He's just took two fighters from scratch to British titles, you know. probably don't get the credit he deserves, to be fair, you know.
But yeah, also, like I said, with him being mature enough, Graham understands that we want to learn as much as we can about boxing, and I want them to learn as much as I can, and I'll take them everywhere I can, or anywhere we can go, and Tenerife was the start of it, and like I said, my next step is America for him. That's where I want him to go. I want him to go and do a month of sparring over there, and you can really find out where you're at then.
Yeah, it'd just be good to see where you're at, you know, getting the gym, sparring every Mexican and every American and his dog, and see how you come out.
Again, for that to be worthwhile, we need to be heading towards some sort of fight. So that is worth for the cost of what going over there and what have you. At the minute, Tenerife, we get a little sponsorship. A fella called Simon from Norwich, brilliant fella, he's helped out right from the off. He gives a little help to get us our villas sorted and what have you. And it costs us nothing to live. You're living on about €50 a week, you know. Especially with the diet we're on, rice and chicken. You know, it doesn't cost nothing. So it's actually cheaper for us to live there than it is here and to do a training camp. So it is actually, it's worked out really well for us. But like I say, in the last, that in our last stop, we're not finished America. We've already been talking about it for the last 6 months. We've got to do 3 months in America and really find out where these two are at.
You, when you started as an amateur, you didn't have the best starts. So for anyone who's now coming into this gym as a youngster, who doesn't has a similar start to yourself, what would you tell them to sort of?
To persevere with it, train as hard as you can every day and as much as you can, and don't lose confidence. Stay in the amateur days. Like you said, I started off, I think I won one or two fights in my first 10. I was terrible, but I stuck with it. Helped to my dad, who constantly put confidence in me and told me I was brilliant, and I wasn't, but he kept telling me I was. And you know, you got to persevere, you got to stick with it, and train harder than everybody else. There's no excuse not to, you know, train every day, work hard, and stick with it. Don't lose confidence, you know. In the amateurs, you do get funny results. Everyone gets them, you know. You got to just keep your chin up and keep going and keep working hard all the time, and never give in, never quit, and just keep working hard, and you'll come good, I'm sure.
Michael, it's a very similar question for yourself.
Mine's a totally different answer. I think in boxing, it's all about the lifestyle, because there's hundreds and thousands of boys out there that could have been British, European, possibly world champions. They just don't know how to live that life, and they're disciplined enough in living life, which is the biggest part of the job. So what I'd advise is, from amateur days, when you have your friends saying, let's go out, let's smoke a bit of weed, let's go and have a beer, and let's do all these silly little things. They're all good fun at the time, things like that, you know, but take you nowhere. If you actually want to be someone in boxing, live that life, be dedicated, be disciplined to your diet, be disciplined to don't put no shit in your body. If you had a robot, you wouldn't go and fill it up with oil and things like that and break it, would you? If it was the only robot you could have. That's what you've got here. You've got your only machine, and you're tipping the shit into it. And I've been and done it. I've done all that. That is the real reason I'm not in boxing how I should be. Because I fucked about all the way through my career. I did. From being 13, I'd go out on a Friday night and drink about the national finals, the night before I went out on the piss, you know. I took liberties, really. I can't say I've done that as a pro. I haven't. I've had 12 pro fights, and I have done a 12-week camp each time. Yeah. But then the rest of the time, I ain't done nothing. I've been out of camp. But yeah, I can't say on my 12 fights, I didn't show up and do a 12-week camp. But it weren't good enough, and that's why I am where I am now. So what I'd advise, live the life. That's more important than anything. And then you'll find out later on, because you don't know how good you're going to be or what you're going to be in boxing until you hit pro, until you get the right learning fights. So first things first, give yourself the right chance with the right diet, put the right things into your body and keep your mind strong. Because if nothing else, drugs and alcohol, anything else, they alter your mind. And boxing's 80% mental. You weaken that as your biggest tool. And I've weakened mine many times and had to fix it. And I just advise, keep a million miles away. Never be controlled by a woman either. That, you know, stick to your boxing. You know?
There we go. The words from Michael and Liam Walsh. Hopefully catch up with you again soon.
Thanks. Well,
plans are to get over to Tenerife for a weekend and see what it's
all
about.
Welcome with us, but I'll tell you, we don't see anybody.
We're like,
I'll show you how good I am at FIFA.
Yeah, no problem.
Cheers, thank you.